This conference will now be recorded.
Good morning, everybody. This topic, I think we are going for ENT optical SPM exams in Jan, February. Am I correct?
Yes, ma'am.
So it will be useful for your community medicine, general medicine, pediatrics, and gynec and OBGY also. So please listen carefully, and I think you all have read in microbiology and pathology about HIV virus. Okay? Who is roll number 131? Roll number 131.
Present, ma'am.
Name? Samira?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Can you tell whatever you know about HIV, just what is the family, genus of HIV virus? Very common topic, no? Microbiology, pathology also dealt the same topic.
Yes, ma'am.
So whatever retro, you know.
HIV virus is a retrovirus.
Okay, it belongs to retroviridae family. Anything else? Genus? Lentivirus,
okay. Ma'am.
Okay, good. Next, roll number 132. Run opposite. Okay, 133. Roll number 133.
Yes, ma'am.
Why you should know about this HIV virus, by the way, especially in pediatrics? Because the, today's topic is pediatric HIV, pediatric human immunodeficiency virus infection. So what is the special about pediatric HIV? Why you have to learn? What is the purpose? Because
early screening.
Answer.
Early screening.
Early screening. Okay. If you do early screening, what will be the use? Early screening of whom? Do you think it's pediatric population or adults? Whom you want to screen early?
Adults, ma'am.
Adults, okay. Then what happens if you screen early? Just think and answer. You are correct. We have to screen early, especially our adolescents and adults. Then what will happen? What will be the result you will get? Roll number 135, 136. So if you screen early, we can detect HIV infection in adults and girls and boys and adults, males and females. Then we can prevent parent to child transmission of HIV. Okay. Roll number 140. Absent. Roll number 120. Roll number, attendance will be recorded for each and everybody who are coming to the classes. How much time you are staying and how much time you are leaving also will be recorded. Accordingly, only attendance will be calculated for your kind information. Sometimes most of you are leaving and coming again. It's not continuously, at least for 1 hour you should listen to the class. No? This is a very, very important topic for your public health and community medicine and pediatrics and general medicine and OBGY. So if you screen early, adolescents and adults, we can prevent parent to child transmission. Why you should prevent parent to child transmission means, if it comes to neonates, most of them will develop severe HIV/AIDS complex by 1 year of age. Almost 25% of children, 20 to 25% of infants will develop into AIDS by 1 year of age. And 50% of them will die by 5 years of age. Okay, so that's why you should screen and you can prevent the transmission of HIV from parent to child. That's the main purpose you should know. Then you will suspect what are the symptoms they will present, what to do, how to investigate these children, and what treatment you have to give. That is the purpose of this today's class. So coming to the disease burden in worldwide, it's almost 36 million persons worldwide were living with HIV infection, according to 2016 census. But more than 90% of these HIV infected individuals live in developing countries like ours, India, and other developing countries. And less than 15 years of age were 2.1 million. Under this 36 million persons worldwide, less than 15% are 2.1 million. This is the worldwide burden of the HIV infection. And among these 2.1 million, only 1/4, 24% of children only getting ART, that is antiretroviral therapy. Of HIV infected children during first year of life, they will develop into AIDS complex. And more than half of the HIV infected children will die before their 50th birthday. That means before 5 years, 50% of children who got infected through the vertical transmission, that is vertical transmission means from the mother to the neonate, we call as vertical transmission of HIV infection. So vertical transmission, this is the prognosis. So 20% they will develop AIDS by first year of age, and 50% of these children will die by fifth birthday of their life. So this is the importance of knowing about the HIV infection, so you can prevent by early screening and giving early, starting early treatment. Coming to the burden of the disease in India, India is the third largest HIV epidemic in the world, the third largest country. And national, coming to the national adult HIV prevalence is around 0.26% in 2015. And coming to the recent 2017, these are the statewide prevalence and the national average is 0.22. So highest is the Mizoram, it's around. Two percent is national average is 0.22. Ours Andhra Pradesh is around 0.63. This is the national average prevalence rate of HIV in India. Coming to the etiology, as already discussed, this belongs to retroviral and lentivirus family. There are two types of HIV viruses, HIV1 and HIV2. HIV1 is the more common cause for HIV infection in children. HIV2 is very rare, and only it is prevalent in African countries, only that too, south part of Africa, not in our country. So whenever you suspect, still you are having doubt regarding HIV2, you have to ask for, especially for HIV antibodies. So HIV2 antibodies, HIV1 is the commonest one. So it's a single stranded RNA, and this genome mainly contains three important components, that is GAG, pol, and envelope parts. GAG part represents the viral core proteins, especially P24 and others. And pol is mainly for the enzymes, viral enzymes like reverse transcriptase, protease, cleavase enzymes. And envelope part, ENV is for envelope, it represents the envelope proteins, especially for GP120 and GP41. So these are the genomic parts, HIV1 genome parts, that's GAG, pol, and envelope. Three important parts are there. Other parts, these are very three important because main represents these proteins like P24 for GAG and pol for reverse transcriptase and cleavase enzymes, and ENV for envelope proteins like GP120 and GP41. So this is the HIV1 and this is the HIV2. You can see this is a GAG, which represents the surface proteins like P24, and pol for the enzymes like reverse transcriptase and cleavase, and ENV for envelope proteins like GP120 and GP41. So what are the modes of transmission in children? So coming to the modes of transmission in children, important mode is the vertical transmission. As I told you, vertical transmission is from mother to the fetus and neonate. So this can occur, vertical transmission, that means transmission of this HIV virus to the baby can occur during intrauterine life, that is antenatal period, intrapartum, that is natal period, during the process of delivery, or through the breastfeeding postnatally. So it can be affected antenatally, natally, postnatally, vertical transmission. And rate, coming to the rate of transmission from mother to child, it varies in different countries, but according to the US and UK studies, around 12 to 30% of transmission may occur through this vertical transmission. But in African countries, it reported around 50% chance from the vertical transmission. So it varies with the countries, most commonly around 12 to 30%, but in African countries, almost 50%. Coming to the other modes like blood products, 3 to 6%. Even with screening also, it should be cautious whenever you are offering blood donation to anybody, if you have blood transmission to any child, because the blood products may be, whenever taking the blood products from the donor, may be during the incubation period. That screening test may not be given correctly whenever it is in incubation period, antibodies may not be detected. So it will be written as screen for HIV will be negative, still there may be chances of transmission of HIV through the blood products. That's why always think twice whenever indication for blood transmission is there. So through blood transmission, it can be transmitted around 3 to 6%. Other routes, sexual abuse in adolescents and small children, unsafe needles usage, like intravenous drug use abusers, and especially adolescents, it is mostly to the sexual contact. These are the modes of transmission of HIV infection in children. Most common is the vertical transmission, followed by blood products, and others are these sexual abuse, unsafe needle usage, and adolescents, they should be taught about the safe sex and HIV infection rate, all those things we have to educate in adolescents. Coming to the vertical transmission, there are some risk factors. If these risk factors are there, the more chances of transmission from the mother to the baby. So what are the risk factors? It's very, very important. All of you note down these points. Whenever there is a preterm delivery, that is less than 34 weeks of gestation, risk of transmission from the mother to baby will be increased. Because as I told you, 12 to 30% chances is there. So it may increase up to 30%. Low maternal antibody, antenatal CD4 counts. So if you go for CD4 count during antenatal period, the mother is screen positive for HIV, then the CD4 counts less means more of viral replication will be there, so the more chances of vertical transmission. Use of illicit drug abuse during pregnancy, more chances of vertical transmission. More than 4 hours duration of rupture of membranes. So usually we call as premature or prolonged rupture of membranes more than 18 hours for the infection, bacterial infection, another infection. For HIV, it's more than 4 hours, more chances of transmission of the HIV infection. And babies, birth weight is low, low birth weight babies, less than 2,500 grams. These are the factors, risk factors, which influence the vertical transmission to higher percentages. So coming to the pathogenesis, as all of you read in microbiology and pathology, these viruses usually lymphotropic, more predilection for T lymphocytes. So, and this T lymphocytes have receptor site, and this virus envelope protein, that is GP120, usually will attach to the T lymphocytes, and this configuration changes will occur. And this virus RNA will enter into the human cytoplasm. After entering the human cytoplasm, reverse transcriptase enzyme, which is present in this virus, will act on this single-stranded viral RNA genome to convert into double-stranded DNA in the host cell. And with the help of integrase enzyme, it will be converted into double-stranded circular DNA, that's a provirion. This viral replication will take place with help of protease enzyme, integrase, and this viral replication will take place, and viral mRNA forms. So then virus replication forms, virus, HIV virus buds through the cell membrane, and after cleavage enzyme by the cleavage action, this will release into the again into the plasma. So this like this newly formed HIV virus will attack other cells, other lymphocytes like that. All lymphocytes will affected. That's why depending upon CD4 lymphocyte count, infection viral load and infection more proneness for opportunistic infections will be takes place. So this enzyme proteins are more prone for error prone, these enzymes on the HIV virus. So these mutant genes will form in the new viruses. That's why we are unable to produce HIV vaccine also. So more in the same individual also, different mutant viruses will be formed because of this enzyme, cleavage enzyme and protease enzymes are more mutant prone. So new viruses will form with mutant genes. So this is the process of HIV infection. So once it enter into the cells, what happens in the host cell? And this HIV infected CD4 cells will unable to control the B lymphocytes. So these will be affected, and also they are unable to control to produce effective antibodies from the B lymphocytes. So both humoral immunity and cell mediated immunity will be affected after HIV infection. So what are the clinical features? Clinical features previously before starting of this highly, what is HART? Roll number 120. 110 absent. Roll number 77. Anybody present?
Yes, ma'am.
Can you tell what is HART? HAART. What do you mean by this?
Highly active antiretroviral therapy, ma'am.
Highly active antiretroviral therapy. Good. So all of you should know at least common things because you are coming for final years. Final year, 8th and 9th semester, you will be going for field visit or maybe you may take cases in the pediatrics and general medicine and OBG. You should know whether the patient had any history of HIV infection or they are using any HART, that is highly active antiretroviral therapy, because manifestation can mimic any common disease. That's a one thing in pediatrics you have to remember. So high suspicion regarding HIV infection in pediatrics should be there because recurrent ear discharge may be the manifestation of HIV infection in the pediatric child. So for that purpose, all of you should listen to the clinical features at least. Previously, they used to have three clinical patterns before the highly active antiretroviral therapy. Rapid progressors, around 15 to 25% of children, they used to develop symptoms within first year of age, and 60 to 80% they used to develop symptoms in 6 to 7 years. Usually they used to be normal up to 8 years of age. Short term, these are called as short term progressors. Long term progressor, very less people, less than 5%, they used to develop symptoms after 8 to 10 years. So this is before HART therapy. Now we are starting, so we can't see all these typical features of rapid progressor, short term progressor and long term progressors. Coming to the clinical manifestations, as I told you, it's widely varied in among infants and children and adolescents, and common diseases will manifest with extensive manifestations and repeated episodes. So the important manifestations in infants and children with lymphadenopathy. Lymphadenopathy, generalized lymphadenopathy can be seen in so many conditions, so many viral infections like infectious mononucleosis, tuberculosis and all other conditions also. But it may be the manifestation of HIV infection. And leptospirochete, we can see in hemolytic anemias, in malaria, tuberculosis and even HIV. Failure to thrive, it's very common if the nutritional intake of the child is less or there is an underlying cardiovascular disease and other conditions also, failure to thrive will be there. So unexplained failure to thrive, there is no cardiac problem, no respiratory problem, mother is offering adequate calories and proteins, but the child is not taking and is going for malnutrition, means we have to think about HIV infection. Chronic and recurrent diarrhea, every monthly or every 15 days is developing diarrhea. So you have to think about there may be underlying HIV. And recurrent pneumonias, usually upper respiratory tract infections can occur per year around 5 to 6 episodes, and lower respiratory tract maybe in less than 5 years children maybe one or two times in 2-3 years. But if the child is having every month, every 2-3 months recurrent pneumonia, if there is more than 3 episodes in lifetime or more than 2 episodes of pneumonia in 6 months, we call as recurrent pneumonia. So if there is recurrent pneumonia, we have to suspect HIV. And oral thrush, that is oral candidiasis, child mother may complain that child may be having white coated tongue and oral mucosa, unable to take food due to the pain. Then we have to think about this oral candidiasis may be the manifestation for HIV infection. These are very, very important symptoms when to suspect HIV, because it looks like common manifestation, common diseases in pediatric case group, but you should have suspicion. There is unusual presentation and recurrent episodes. Other features are recurrent otitis media, as I told you, recurrent ear discharge. They come with the mother, we may say, recurrent purulent discharge from the ears. Diagnosis may be otitis media. So whatever antibiotics you use, temporary relief will occur again. After 10 or 15 days, they will again come with ear discharge. So recurrent otitis media is one of the manifestation of HIV. We have to suspect. We have to advise for screening for HIV. And tuberculosis, pulmonary or extrapulmonary tuberculosis or lymph node tuberculosis may be the manifestation of HIV. And what is PCP? Anybody? What do you mean by PCP? PCP prophylaxis also we will tell. roll number 13, present or absent? Roll number 13. Roll number 15. Roll number 15, absent. Okay, I will only tell what is PCP, pneumocystis carinii pneumonia or pneumocystis jirovec. Now they are calling pneumocystis jirovec pneumonia. So this is the one of the manifestations specifically for a pediatric HIV. Pyrexia of unknown origin. What do you mean by pyrexia of unknown origin? Anybody can define what is PUO? Fever of more than 101 degree Fahrenheit for more than
1 week, ma'am.
1 week with investigation, without investigation, 3 weeks. Okay, more than 1 week with investigations, not able to find any origin, then we call as fever of or pyrexia of unknown origin. So that may be the manifestation of HIV. Recurrent bacterial infections, any site like folliculitis, carbuncles or pyoderma, like that also, if they're recurrently having same problem, you have to think. And chronic parotid swelling, if the pediatric case group children are having parotid mumps like swelling, but it's mumps is acute, usually it subsides within 5 to 7 days. Still, if it is persisting for more than 2-3 weeks, parotid swelling, you have to think about HIV infection in that child. Lymphoid interstitial pneumonitis, this is also specific to the pediatric case group, less common in adults. And early onset of progressive neurological deterioration, this is also more common in pediatric case group. Okay, so these are the clinical manifestation of HIV, not common manifestation. Rarely you can see so many skin manifestations, GIT manifestations, cardiovascular manifestations, some CNS and renal. I will tell in detail in the later slides. So coming to the classification, previously they used to classify different, but now WHO classification is clinical staging and immunological staging. Only two staging they will use for classifying the patients, but for treatment, whether it's whatever the clinical staging, whatever maybe the immunological staging, we have to start antiretroviral active antiretroviral therapy once the diagnosis is confirmed. So clinical stage one is asymptomatic. Usually they may have lymphadenopathy, that's all. No other symptoms, no fever, other symptoms won't be there. Mild symptoms is clinical stage two. Advanced symptoms is clinical stage three and severe symptoms. Coming to the, what are the symptoms in clinical stage one? As I told you, they may not be have any symptoms at all, or maybe just persistent generalized lymphadenopathy. Like axillary lymph nodes will be there, axillary will be there, cervical will be there, and inguinal if it is there. So we have to, so that is called as generalized. More than two non-conspicuous sites are involved, then we call as generalized lymphadenopathy, and size should be more than 1 centimeter in cervical and axillary areas, and in inguinal more than 2 centimeters in size. Then we call as generalized, persistent generalized lymphadenopathy. It may be the manifestation of HIV. You have to screen those children. And clinical stage two, unexplained persistent leptospirochemia. There is no hemolytic anemia, no other cause, no infective etiology, other like bacterial infections like tuberculosis or typhoid excluded, or Kalazar and other parasitic infections. Then we have to think about HIV. And papillary pruritic eruptions over the skin, fungal nail infections. Pediatric case group, fungal nail infections are very, very rare. Only seen in adults who are involved in continuous wetting their hands, like housemaids or some dobies and all those people, only fungal infection of the nails will be there. But in pediatric case group, if you are able to diagnose fungal nail infection, we have to suspect HIV. And repeated angular keelitis, linear gingival erythema, extensive your virus infection, warts are there skin over the skin, and extensive molluscum contusiosum. Molluscum contusiosum can be seen in pediatric case group, but one or two lesions will be there. But extensive is very rare. Whenever there is extensive molluscum contusiosum, then we have to think about HIV. And recurrent oral ulcerations, like in SLE, systemic lupus erythematosus, we may observe oral ulcers. Those are will be painless. Other features of SLE will be observed, like butterfly rash and all. But without any butterfly rash, if there are recurrent painful oral ulcers are occurring, along with sometimes oral candidiasis, we have to think it's a case of HIV. And unexplained persistent parotid enlargement, as I told, it comes in clinical stage two. Herpes zoster also, it is very rare in pediatric case group, because they should have chickenpox, then that virus will present in the ganglion. Later in the adult age group or old age group, they will develop herpes zoster, especially in diabetics and all those person. But it is observed in pediatric case group, like less than 5 years and 8 years, like child with extensive herpes zoster over the dermatomal region, we have to think it's most likely HIV case. I've seen cases with this herpes zoster manifestation pediatrics. After HIV screening, it came to be positive. So we have to think of extensive skin lesions like herpes zoster, molluscum contusiosum, warts. We have to think about HIV. Recurrent or chronic upper respiratory tract infections like otitis media, running nose, that is otorrhea, and ear discharge, rhinorrhea. Maybe sometimes if they're present in combination, otitis media with otorrhea, that is ear discharge, sinusitis, and tonsillitis recurrently, we have to exclude HIV. Clinical stage three, it is unexplained moderate malnutrition, wasting, not adequately responding standard therapy, nutritionally increased your calorie intake and protein intake of the child. Still, it is not recovering. We have to think about clinical stage three of HIV. Unexplained persistent diarrhea. Acute diarrhea means less than 14 days of onset. If it is more than 14 days, it may be persistent or chronic. But chronic diarrhea is non-infective etiology, like malabsorption. Chloride diarrhea comes under chronic diarrhea. Infective etiology lasting for more than 14 days or more, we call as persistent diarrhea. So unexplained persistent diarrhea in a pediatric case group may be the manifestation of HIV. Unexplained persistent fever above 37.5 degrees Celsius intermittently or constantly for more than 1 month, unexplained fever for more than 1 month, always to exclude HIV. Persistent oral candidiasis. Usually newborns up to 4 weeks or 6 weeks is normal. You see their tongue sometimes will be curd precipitates will be there, that's normal. But beyond 6 weeks of life, the child or infant is having oral candidiasis, always think about HIV. Oral hearing leukoplakia, acute necrotizing, ulcerative gingivitis, lymph node tuberculosis, pulmonary tuberculosis, any tuberculosis. Usually tuberculosis and HIV may be coexisting. So you have to do tuberculosis test and HIV test, whether it's lymph node or pulmonary or extra pulmonary tuberculosis. And chronic HIV associated lung disease, including bronchiectasis, may be the manifestation. And sometimes they may present with anemia with aprosopagnemagia. That's why if any case of anemia with aprosopagnemagia is there, along with hemolytic anemias like sickle cell and sickle cell anemia and thalassemias, differential diagnosis will be HIV and also disseminated tuberculosis. So HIV may be less than 8 grams per deciliter, neutropenia that is less than 5,000 per cubic mm, or chronic thrombocytopenia less than 50,000 per cubic mm, platelet count may be the manifestation of HIV. No other cause is there, means we have to screen for HIV. Coming to the clinical stage 4, all are there in our OPG, no textbook, you can read from that, no need to write, just listen. Unexplained severe wasting and stunting, severe, that is SAM, severe acute malnutrition, you have to exclude HIV before starting treatment, because whatever treatment you give without screening HIV, without starting HIV, child may not require with your standard therapy. Pneumocystis or pneumocystis carinii pneumonia, pneumocystis gyrovesi pneumonia, recurrent severe bacterial infection such as empyema, pyomyositis, bone or joint infections like arthritis, osteomyelitis, meningitis, all can be the manifestation in case of clinical stage 4. Extrapulmonary also comes under stage 4. Kaposi's sarcoma, it's very rare in pediatric case group, that if it is there means it's clinical stage 4. And HIV encephalopathy is more common in pediatric case group. Coming to the immune classification, depending upon CD4 count, there is a classification that is not that significant immunodeficiency, mild immunodeficiency, advanced immunodeficiency, and severe immunodeficiency. Why you should know whether child is in asymptomatic without any immunodeficiency or advanced or severe immunodeficiency for vaccination purpose and to take care of this child from preventing opportunistic infections, we need immunological classification. So this also varies with the age of the child. The child is less than 11 months, the child is 12 to 35 months or 36 to 59 months, more than 5 years. So depending upon that, this is also there in your OPG textbook. Can read, repeated reading only can remember this table. It may be asked in your community medicine or pediatrics. We may get clinical classification of HIV infection in child or immune classification of HIV infection for 4 marks. So you have to remember that non-significant is CD4 count should be more than 35%. So 5-5 we have to reduce. More than 30% in case of 12 to 35, more than 25%, more than 500. If the age of the child is more than 5 years, will take absolute CD4 counts. Okay, so severe immunodeficiency, CD4 count is less than 25% of the total lymphocytes in less than 11 months, less than 20% in case of 12 to 35 months, and less than 15% in case of 36 months to 15 months, and absolute neutrophil CD4 counts is less than 200, or percentage less than 15% is always indicates severe immunodeficiency. Coming to the other non-specific manifestations, as I told you, PU of more than 1 month, weight loss of more than 10% in last 6 months. So there is recorded evidence of weight. The weight loss is more than 10%. Have to think about HIV infection. Diarrhea more than 1 month. They may be around 50% of HIV children. 90% of children may have failure to thrive on growth retardation. That's why they may manifest like protein energy malnutrition. You have to screen for tuberculosis and HIV in those children before starting treatment. Aprosopagnemagia and generalized lymphadenopathy. These are non-specific. These are the photographs, clinical photographs, courtesy from Dr. Nitin Kesha. He is a pioneer in infectious diseases and hematology, senior most pediatrician. These are photos from his textbook. So here you can see aprosopagnemagia. So aprosopagnemagia, you can see spleen, huge, large aprosopagnemagia, unexplained without any hemolytic anemia, we have to think about HIV. And also child may be like cachectic, proteinuria malnutrition, SAM, grade 3 or grade 4, IAP classification, and had to think about HIV. Coming to the opportunistic infections which are common in pediatric case group. There may be viral, bacterial, fungal, or protozoal. Coming to the bacterial opportunistic infections, Mycobacterium tuberculosis is a common, followed by Mycobacterium avium intracellular, that's a typical mycobacteria. And the viral, CME, that is cytomegalovirus, herpes, Epstein-Barr virus, molluscum, varicella. Varicella also will have extensive varicella lesions. Usually varicella occurs, chickenpox occurs only once in a lifetime. If any person giving the history of repeated episodes, more than one episode of chickenpox, we have to screen for, we have to ask the child or the adult to get for HIV screening. And measles also, if they get, there will be extensive measles and repeated episodes of measles infection. You have to think about HIV screening. Coming to fungal candidiasis, is very common, or may manifest with neoformans, CNS, they can manifest. Protozoal, that is pneumocystis carinii, GWS infection, toxoproxamosis, cryptosporidium. Cryptosporidium can manifest with diarrhea and malabsorption features. So most of 30 to 50% of children with AIDS will present with opportunistic infections is there means is already immunodeficiency. That's why opportunistic infections are coming. So about 20% of AIDS defining illnesses may be due to the poor antibody response. As I told you, usually CD4, healthy T4 cells will control the B lymphocytes also while for production of antibodies. So it will, because CD4 counts will be decreased and diseased CD4 counts, they can't regulate the B lymphocytes for immune antibody production. And if these antibodies produced also, they won't be that much effective. So they will have hypergammaglobulinemia in spite of the infections, but they won't be functioning normally. So that's why these children are more prone for recurrent severe systemic infections and non-responsive to the treatment. Most often by capsular organisms like pneumococci, H influenza will be affecting these children repeatedly. So internal organs infections and abscesses very common like meningitis, pneumonitis, pneumonias, septic arthritis, and they may have more than two episodes of invasive infections in 2 years. Usually they won't get lifetime one invasive infection. This is very rare. If they're getting more than two episodes in 2 years duration, always think about immunodeficiency, whether it's acquired or congenital immunodeficiency. Candidiasis, as I told you, most common fungal infection in children presenting with oral candidiasis and diarrhea. And tuberculosis, all forms of tuberculosis is common in HIV infected children, including pulmonary lymph node tuberculosis and extrapulmonary tuberculosis like bone TB and meningeal tuberculosis is common. Coming to the pneumocystis jirovecii, sometimes maybe ask for 4 marks question separately. We may ask PCP pneumonia. Nowadays, it's not called as carni, it's a jirovecii. So this is the most common opportunistic infection in infants. That means less than 1 year. Usually they are present with acute onset of fever, high grade fever, and acute onset of dyspnea. Child may be having retractions, tachypnea, and cough, and cyanosis will be there. Only 2 days history will be there. But if you see this child will be failure to thrive, underweight, and length is also defective. So anthropometric measurements are less than the normal. And if you take proper history, then if you see the mother, maternal antenatal screening for HIV, you may get clue. Sometimes you have to ask for the occupation of the father, especially migrating people and drivers are more prone for this HIV infection. So you have to ask the father occupation also. So that gives clue to you. So what investigation will do for these children with the suspected PCP, that is pneumocystis carinii pneumonia, X-ray chest and pulmonary function test and gallium scan. So the radiological findings usually like diffuse interstitial infiltrates will be there. And these, if you see today and tomorrow, if you repeat the X-ray, very rapidly progressing radiological findings and deterioration of the condition also will be, even with toxin supplementation also, sinuses won't subside. That's why you have to think about PCP, atypical pneumonias in children with HIV. So if you go for the GM staining, especially sputum, these children, 30% chance of detecting the PCP. and its bronchoalveolar level 60 to 90%, bronchoalveolar biopsy 97%. Treatment usually we will give intravenous cotrimoxazole. Total duration of cotrimoxazole we have to give for 21 days, but once the child is stable we can switch over to IV to oral therapy. So this is X-ray for infant with PCP pneumonia or pneumocystis jirovecii pneumonia. We can observe here diffuse white infiltrates. Actually, if there is no HIV, we'll label it as bronchopneumonia. But if you suspect HIV, send for the X-ray reporting. They will give diffuse infiltrates, maybe bronchopneumonia or PCP pneumonia. So you can go for Gram stain. Gram stain will be like this. Yes, sir. PCP pneumonia, it may be from the sputum or bronchoalveolar lavage. So these are the some of the photos of opportunistic infections in children. What is this? Anybody can label? What is this photo on skin lesion? There is erythematous rash and actually very painful vesicles also there. It's not that much clearly seen, but it's erythematous vesicular rash in a dermatomal pattern. What is your diagnosis?
Herpes zoster.
You have to be specific. Herpes zoster. And what is this diagnosis? You can see some white, curdy prostrates over the tongue and oral mucosa. Are you able to see?
Oral candidiasis.
Oral candidiasis or oral thrush. So in this age group, it's very rare. Immunodeficiency, maybe due to chronic steroids uses, or maybe congenital immunodeficiency, or maybe acquired immunodeficiency. Our long-term uses of antibiotics, broad-spectrum antibiotics also will leads to like this. But we have to suspect and screen for HIV. You can see cachectic child with malnourished, only bones are visible, no fat at all. So most probably HIV. What is this photo? Diagnosis. So because if you observe these type of children, you can suspect and can screen for that. So nobody will come that I am having HIV or mother, my child is having HIV positive. They may not be knowing at all. Sometimes parents may not be, they went to some doctor, again it came, they may come to another doctor. So the doctor may not be knowing that it's repeated episodes also. So they may change the doctors also. They don't know that the child is having HIV also. Parents may not be knowing. So you have to suspect, you have to screen the child and also screen the parents, then only parents, then you know that parents are HIV positive. Like cases happen like that. So you have to suspect with the clinical presentations like this. What is this diagnosis? Skin lesions, at least describe this skin lesions. Is it abnormal? Never seen this type of lesions in any child or the adults. Here, you can tell in English or Telugu. What do you call these skin lesions? Anybody? Folliculitis, furuncles, furunculosis, we call as furunculosis. In Telugu, they call it staggered blue. Like that, they will tell, no. So these are the furunculosis, extensive furunculosis, follicle inflammation of follicle leading to furuncle formation, extensive. It's well, it's seen in adults with severe uncontrolled diabetes, extensive folliculosis and furuncles will be there. But in pediatric case group, you have to suspect immunodeficiency. Most probably HIV or other congenital immunodeficiency. So furunculosis, extensive furunculosis, usually one or two lesions we will see. Usually summer sweaty times, usually they may get one or two lesions like this. They will come to the pediatric OP or dermatology OP. But it's extensive like scalp, face, neck, upper part of the upper limbs. All parts are involved with this much extensively. With short duration, they will come with short duration. So you have to suspect HIV or immunodeficiency. Coming to the manifestations of respiratory manifestation of HIV, in pediatric case group, lymphoid interstitial pneumonia is more common. The age of the child is less than 1 year, we have to think about PCP pneumonia, that is pneumocystis jirovecii pneumonia. Age of the child is more than 1 year, we have to think about lymphoid interstitial pneumonia. Almost 40 to 50% prevalence in pediatric and less common in adults. Usually it's seen in vertically transmitted infected children. That means mother is positive and the child get the HIV infection. Those children, they will present with lymphoid interstitial pneumonia. In older age, younger age less than 1 year, PCP pneumonia. Investigations, X-ray chest, lung biopsy may be confirmatory. Prognosis, very bad. Usually they won't survive more than 5 years, that is 60 to 70 months means not more than 5 years after the diagnosis. So this will be the radiological picture of this lymphoid interstitial pneumonia. Like hazy infiltrates will be seen diffusely. Next, coming to the CNS manifestations, HIV. Usually it's a neutrotropic also, lymphotropic and neutrotropic HIV virus. So primary CNS involvement may be there, especially in pediatric case group. It may be due to HIV virus itself, or maybe opportunistic infections like fungal meningitis can happen, or TB meningitis can happen, or tumors that are more prone for intracranial tumors, and drugs used for HIV can cause encephalopathy. Now, HIV encephalopathy, whenever it is diagnosed, early initiation of highly active antiretroviral therapy had to start. They may present with the developmental delay, poor scholastic performance, that means they are not able to get good scores in the school, and seizures, altered sensorium later. Coming to the GIT manifestation of HIV, like oral candidiasis, systemic candidiasis, periodontal diseases like gingivitis, angular stromatitis, all those they can present, and they may present with hairy leukoplakia, recurrent ulcers. This is upper GIT, and may they present with lower GIT symptoms like chronic recurrent diarrhea with malabsorption, abdominal pain, dysphagia, because of oral esophageal candidiasis will also be there. So they may not swallow the, they have pain while swallowing the food. So dysphagia, failure to thrive, these are the common manifestations of GIT. Sometimes they may have AIDS enteropathy. That's a syndrome of malabsorption with partial illness atrophy due to HIV, called as AIDS or HIV enteropathy. And there may be hepatosplenomegaly, and then fluctuating serum amylases will be there. Without hepatitis, they may have liver enzymes will be SGOT, SGPT will be elevated. Next, coming to the CVS manifestation. These are very important, not only for your theory and practical examinations, for your PG entrance also. All are features of cardiovascular manifestation of HIV, except they will write like that. So you should know what are the features of cardiovascular features of HIV infection. Then only will be able to answer the PG entrance beat. So the cardiovascular manifestations are dilated cardiomyopathy, left ventricular hypertrophy, pulmonary hypertension, and congestive cardiac failure. These are the manifestations of CVS is involved. Coming to the renal manifestation of HIV, especially they may present with nephrotic syndrome, is the most common manifestation of pediatric renal HIV. That's why if any child with nephrotic syndrome, we will send for HIV and hepatitis B virus. Both can manifest with nephrotic syndrome in pediatric case group. So HIV infection and hepatitis B virus infection can present with nephrotic syndrome, and usually rapidly progresses to end stage renal disease. Prognosis is bad. Next, coming to the dermatovascular disorder. Can anybody diagnose this skin lesions? Anybody interested in dermatology? What are these skin lesions? I will describe. Vesiculated, central umbilicated vesicles in crops, multiple lesions for the upper limb and part of the chest and neck. Umbilicated vesicles, what is our diagnosis? Very infective also. If you touch, you may get this skin lesions. So that's why you should be very cautious while examining. Should wear your gloves, then only you should examine. What is this? Anybody? It's a molluscum contagiosum, very extensive. Usually you may see one or two lesions in lower socioeconomic status children with poor hygiene, but if this much lesions are there, means immunosuppressed individual, HIV or other immunosuppression. So in dermatology, they may present with seborrheic dermatitis, severe eczema, recurrent or chronic episodes of herpes simplex virus infection, herpes zoster, molluscum contagiosum. This is a molluscum contagiosum. Coming to the immunological problems, as I told you, anemia, leukopenia, thrombocytopenia may be there, and these children are more prone for thrombosis, thrombus formation and complications of thrombosis, mainly due to hyperviscosity. As I told you, hypergammaglobulinemia will be there, but these antibodies will not be functioning normally. So ineffective antibodies will more leading to hypergammaglobulinemia, which increases viscosity of the blood and more prone for thrombosis. Not only that, allow me that protein C and protein S deficiency, anticoagulants, protein S and protein C are anticoagulants. So these are deficient means these children will prone for thrombosis. Thrombosis means depending upon the part affected, they may present with hemiplegia, seizures, focal nodular blood exits. Some malignancies, non-Hodgkin lymphoma and CNS lymphomas are common in these children. But Kaposi's sarcoma, which is common in adults, is rare in pediatric age group. Kaposi's sarcoma is caused by human herpes virus 6-8. So how to diagnose HIV in pediatric age group? So depending on the age of the child, we have to go for the investigations. If the child is less than 18 months, there may be chances of transmission of antibodies, HIV antibodies from the mother to the child along with the placenta. Whether child is infected or not, there may be antibodies. So if you go for ELISA test, it may be falsely positive. So in case of less than 18 months, we have to go for virological testing only. So the child is non-breastfed, breastfeeding not at all given, then we have to go for the virological testing at 6 weeks of age. And if it is positive, repeat the test again after 6 weeks. It's still positive. It's child is HIV infected. We have to treat the child. The virological testing at 6 weeks is negative. Non-breastfed baby is a non-HIV child. Breastfeeding given to the child, then we will go for the virological testing at 6 weeks. Repeat is positive. We have to repeat it again after 6 weeks. And if it is a positive, HIV infected. So virological testing at 6 weeks is negative. Still, you have to repeat the test because child is getting breastfeeding. There is still chance of transmission of virus to the breast milk. So then after that, if it is positive, means we have to repeat. And if it is positive, you have to treat the child. After stopping the breastfeeding, if it is negative, so child is not infected. This is the algorithm that how to investigate the child suspected child born to HIV positive mother. The age of the child is less than 18 months. So always go for PCR or virological testing. If the child age is more than 18 months, then we can go for antibody testing, HIV antibody, that is ELISA, we can go. So non-breastfed baby not received any breastfeeding at all. So antibody test after 18 months, positive, that's a confirmed case of HIV. Negative, it's not HIV. Breastfed child, HIV antibody test, positive, confirmed case. In negative, we can repeat after stopping of breastfeeding, 6 to 8 weeks after stopping of breastfeeding. Confirm, positive, confirm, negative, not infected. But anytime in between, if the child is having symptoms suggestive of HIV, we have to repeat the test. Coming to the management and treatment, high index of suspicion and timely diagnosis is very, very important to monitor the, to get the good growth and development, brain development. So mainly psychosocial support is very, very important, and special is immunization. So if the child is positive, symptomatic, you should not give live virus vaccines. And always take steps to prevent the parent to child transmission of HIV infection. Coming to this, very, very important for practical purpose and your daily practice. So asymptomatic HIV child, you can give all vaccines, including live vaccines also. That means child is not having any symptoms of HIV, only is positive for HIV virus. Then we can give all killed and live vaccines. But symptomatic HIV positive child, live vaccine should be avoided, like measles. BCG usually will give at birth. By that time, you don't know the status of the HIV status of the child, and child may not be symptomatic. So it can give BCG to all children at birth in our country, because it prevents tuberculosis, especially extensive tuberculosis and extrapulmonary tuberculosis. And OPV also, it's a live virus vaccine. At birth we can give. Later, if the child is symptomatic, and HIV positive and symptomatic, better to avoid oral polio vaccine, because it can cause paralytic poliomyelitis. So better to go for inactivated polio virus vaccine or injectable polio virus vaccine, that is killed vaccine. It is available in our India also. So we can go for the IPV instead of OPV to a child born to HIV positive mother and symptomatic. And not only to the child, the children who are living along with this HIV positive child also should receive IPV, because OPV will be excreted in the stools and urine that may contaminate the and affect the other children who are immunocompromised. So not HIV positive child, and also children who are living with HIV positive should receive IPV only, injectable poliovirus vaccine only, killed vaccine. All killed and subunit vaccines like hepatitis B and hepatitis A can be given safely. But we have to monitor sero response, whether additional doses are needed or not, because immune response may not be that good. So not like DPT, primary two, three doses, next, first and second boosters. So they may not get, so may be given additional doses. Passive prophylaxis, because varicella and measles can affect CNS also in these children. So whenever they get the contact with measles or varicella person, better to give passive prophylaxis, that is immunoglobulins, and treat the child. There is no, these vaccines should not be given to a child who are symptomatic. Measles and chickenpox vaccines should not be given. Remember that. So these are the main aims of antiretroviral therapy: to immune preservation, lesser infections. So there is no cure. In future, we get just we are just treating the symptoms and controlling the virus replication. That's all. Whatever available antiretroviral therapy, we are controlling the multiplication of the virus. So coming to the, what are the types of antiretroviral drugs are available? These are nucleoside reverse transcriptase inhibitors and non-nucleoside reverse transcriptase inhibitors. Like nucleoside reverse transcriptase, I think by this time all of you know, like duravidin, strividin, lamivudin, abacavir, these are the nucleoside reverse transcriptase inhibitors. Non-nucleoside reverse transcriptase, never have been widely used, and efavirenz, this is the safest drug. And other drugs are protease inhibitors, indinavir and these drugs. And newer drugs are fusion inhibitor. At the fusion of viral virus into the lymph cells, that is CD4 containing T lymphocytes, it prevents fusion at that. So these drugs are recent drugs. So antineutral drugs, like as I told you, fusion inhibitors usually inhibit the fusion of HIV variant to the lymphocyte membrane. So not available orally, it's only available parenterally, subcutaneously or IV we have to give. Treatment, as current WHO guidelines is, treat all children who are positive for the HIV. Do not, no need of depend upon clinical staging or immunological staging. Previously they used to treat only immunodeficient symptomatic children only because of unavailable of ART. Now it's widely available in ART centers. Even at Elur we are having big ART center, so there we can refer these children and adults for the treatment. These are the combinations. Regimen for at least two nucleotide reverse transcriptase enzymes should be there in the drugs of this group, and plus one non-nucleotide reverse transcriptase. I have to see this, two NRTA and one NNRTAs. And but should take that, should not use duravidin and savidin in same regime, because one causes anemia. Duravidin so should not be given in anemic children. HB, if it is more than 9 grams only, they have to use duravidin. So clinical monitoring should be there. CD4 counts should be monitored. So prevention mainly by safe blood and blood products, safe sexual practices, disinfection by heat and bleach, universal precautions while you go for clinical rounds or while taking cases, you should take proper precautions, wear gloves if there is HIV positive child or the person, protective measures and hand washing, disposable or disposable while handling the sharp should be very careful. So these are the phases of prevention of mother to child or prevention of from parent to child transmission of HIV. What is phase one? As already somebody told, early screening and modification of life skills. Antenatal counseling and voluntary counseling and testing, ANC, that is antenatal counseling and voluntary counseling and testing. That is a phase one information we will give. Phase two is prophylaxis. Once HIV positive, we have to give PCP prophylaxis and drugs during antenatal period. But once the baby is delivered, that is infant feeding, you have to opt, what is RF means? Replacement feeding. E means exclusive breastfeeding. We have to counsel the mother. What are the benefits of exclusive breastfeeding? What are the disadvantages of breastfeeding when HIV positive is there? So decision should be taken by the mother herself only. Finally, social support. So because 5 to 20% of infants breastfed by HIV may be infected, these percentages better to remember, you write a separate notebook for how much through the breast milk, how much through the delivery process, what is what, how much percentage of vertical, these may come for PG entrance weight. For that purpose, we have to remember those numericals, 5 to 20% through the breast milk. So we will ask exclusive replacement of feeding, should not be mixed feeding. That's a fundamental. All of you remember, mother should not give breast milk and cow milk at a time, like a bottle feeding for a daytime and nighttime breast milk. There are more chances of oral mucous dermis, more entry of HIV infection, so more chances of getting infection. So mother has to go for exclusive breastfeeding. That means nothing has to be given up to 6 months, only mother's milk or replacement milk with cow's milk or formula milk. But we had to educate the mother regarding the replacement feeding, because in our country like India, most of the low social middle class people will dilute milk, or they may give with bottles without proper hygiene, leading to diarrhea and malnutrition. The child may die before HIV manifestations with protein edge malnutrition. So we have to educate the mother and tell her the disadvantages of bottle feeding and artificial feeding. So what are the feeding? Mainly WHO recommendation, avoid all breastfeeding. If replacement feeding is acceptable, feasible, affordable, they should afford for the cow's milk or formula feeding, and should be sustainable. She should not change to breastfeeding in between, they can't afford, and should be safe and hygienic. Then only we will opt for the replacement feeding. So we have to counsel the mother according to the under 5 mortality, maternal mortality, and HIV prevalence in that area. So prevention of parent to child transmission of HIV, we have to start antenatal screening and antenatal treatment with antiretroviral therapy. And better choice is elective cesarean section, because as I told you, more than 4 hours of rupture of membrane, artificial rupture of membrane, should not be done. There are more chances of transmission of HIV. And feeding according to the maternal financial status, educational status, and after opting by the mother, we can go for replacement feeding to decrease the chances of transmission. Otherwise, breastfeeding has to be given. So mother comes late in the labor and not taking any antiretroviral therapy, are taken for less than 4 weeks, we have to give judavidine to the baby for 4 weeks. The mother comes during labor also, we have to give for 4 weeks. Otherwise, mother antenatally used antiretroviral therapy means we can give judavidine for 1 week. Orally, that's more than sufficient. Or nevirapine we can give. So this is post-exposure prophylaxis. Whenever your internship posting or clinical round, take care of yourselves with proper precautions. By mistake, if any leaflet injury occurs, what has to broken skin, depending upon the volume of but contaminated small rest titrate of HIV will be there. So we have to discuss, depending on condition, we can go for the ART. But is the high viral load is there in that person, basic post-exposure prophylaxis has to be taken. If it is large volume of blood to a broken skin, expanded post-exposure prophylaxis has to be taken in case of HIV titers are high in that person. Intact skin, low risk. There is no chance of, no need of post-exposure prophylaxis. But intact skin, there is like recent cuts are there, something you suspect, better go for post-exposure prophylaxis, basic only. Percutaneous, like needle sticks or something accidentally gone, then more severe condition of the person, we have to go for the expanded post-exposure prophylaxis. So any doubts are there, at least when to suspect HIV you got, what are the investigations available? Less than 18 years, always viral culture or PCR, that is polymerase chain reaction. For P24 antigen, it's better. More than 18 months, we can go for the antibody test, that is ELISA, we can do. And in investigations, other opportunistic infections, like a chest X-ray, depending upon CSF analysis, we go. And how to prevent is more important. Prevention of HIV infection to the child from the parent. Any doubts are there? Any doubts? There are no doubts. I will end the meeting. Today, Jyoti Prakash is absent, is not talking at all. Jyoti Prakash? Okay, then I will end the meeting. Okay?
Thank you, ma'am.
Okay, thank you. Bye.